Welcome to Hindu Analysis, August 15, 2018. Freedom in our mind, faith in the words, pride in our hearts and memories in our soul. Let's salute the 72nd Independence Day. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is Mahadai Tribunal allows Karnataka to divert water. So what the news here is, the Mahadai Water Tribunal recently told to the Union Water Resources Minister to divert 13.5 TMCFT of water to Karnataka for its irrigation as well as for its agricultural purposes. So whatever the tribunal's award which is given now should be or to be adhered until August 2048. So it is valid until 2048. The water should get diverted to Karnataka, this much amount of water. But what the major concern here is, the Goa is now historically opposed this diversion of water to Karnataka, stating that diversion of water to Karnataka will cause deficit of water in the future as well as it causes major imbalance and it lead to ecological disaster in the future. So if you see this picture, this is Mahadai River. So it starts or originates from Karnataka and it flows through Goa. It is of 81 kilometer in length. So there is one project which is ongoing, which is Kalasa Bandura project in Karnataka. So under this project, the Karnataka government actually proposed the construction of dams as well as the canals to divert this Mahadai River's water to address the water deficit which is present in this Malaprabha river basin which is present in Karnataka. So because of this diversion of water only, there exist a lot of conflicts between Goa, Karnataka as well as Maharashtra. So as of now, if we are going to see what this Mahadai Water Tribunal, so it is getting constituted in the year 2010 for resolving the dispute over the sharing of water, which is this Mahadai River's water, between three states, which is this Karnataka, Goa as well as Maharashtra. So as per the recent MWT award, the Karnataka should get a water diversion of 13.5 TMC feet and Goa should get 24 TMC feet and Maharashtra should get 1.33 TMC feet. So this MWT was constituted in the year 2010 under the Section 3 of Interstate River Water Disputes Act 1956. So if you see about this Mahadai River, it is of length 81 kilometer, where it spreads across 29 kilometer in Karnataka, and in Goa it extends up to a length of 52 kilometer. So its origin is Bhimgad, Belagavi district, which is in Karnataka. So as we said, this Mahadai River length is spread across 29 kilometer in Karnataka and nearly 52 kilometer in Goa. So this Mahadai River has a major tributary of 19, of which Kalasa and Banduri are very important tributaries, upon which this Kalasa Banduri project is taken place by Karnataka government. So the second article is 300 army officers move Supreme Court against prosecution. So what the news here is, the Supreme Court directed the CBI to file the charge sheets against the army officers who are getting involved in the Manipur extrajudicial killings by branding the innocent people as insurgents. So this is the news. So if you see the background information, then the Supreme Court stated that there is no concept of absolute immunity for the armed forces. So that is what they stated. If any army person is involving in this extrajudicial killing, then there is no complete immunity provided for him under the judiciary. This is what the Supreme Court stated in July 2016. So any army man, if he committed any offense, then he is under the purview of the judiciary. So this judgment by the Supreme Court came after hundreds of families in Manipur seeking the probe of alleged fake encounters by the armed forces over the innocent people. For that only, the Supreme Court stated like that. That means there is no absolute immunity for the armed forces if they involve in this extrajudicial killing. And in April 2017, the center asks the Supreme Court to reconsider this July 2016 verdict. So in July 30, 2018, the CBI also assures the Supreme Court that the CBI is doing its best to prosecute these persons who are guilty for this Manipur encounters. So in very recently, August 13, 2018, the Supreme Court seeks or asks the center's response on this public interest litigation on accusing the armed forces for allegedly involving in this fake encounters. So for that public interest litigation, now from the armed forces side, they are filing their own petition, which stating that there always exist extraordinary circumstances prevailing over the region, especially in the insurgency hit areas as well as in the nation's border region. There only these armed forces are put in place. So now they need some kind of immunity over these kind of laws. So the Supreme Court's recent orders as well as the resultant CBI action now demoralize the officers and the troops who are getting deployed in those insurgent hit areas. These kind of immunities are not provided for the armed forces. Then fighting the counter-terrorism as well as counter-insurgency in Jammu and Kashmir and northeastern states will become difficult. So in the same petition, what they are also telling is the armed forces, if they are not given the adequate protection or the immunity, then it would cause grave peril to our nation's sovereignty and integrity, and it may challenge their very existence. So in the petition, what they are also telling is the OFSPA, which is given power to the armed forces, did not give a vague protection or a blanket protection for the armed forces. It just facilitates the soldiers' functioning and operations in extraordinary circumstances, which is prevailing over Jammu and Kashmir and northeastern states. So the third article is rupee breached 70 to a dollar, which means now it become $1 equal to 70 rupees. So why? Because of the Turkish crisis. So now the Turkish currency lira is getting depreciated, and because of that wavering effect, now it has a contagious effect over all the emerging markets. Similarly, Indian rupee or Indian currency is also getting depreciated. So already we are facing these many issues, which pushing the domestic currency to a fresh time low, which is equivalent to 70 rupees per dollar. This Turkish lira is also now impacting our currency's value. So what the finance ministry is telling for this is, this fall or depreciation in our Indian currency is mainly due to the external factors like the trade wars between US and China, etc. So nothing to worry, this depreciation was in line with other currency. Not only Indian currency is getting depreciated, but all the emerging market economies' currency is also getting depreciated. While comparing with the depreciation of other markets' currencies, our currency is not depreciating that much. So that is what he told. And all weakening, but rupee is not that much weakening when compared to the other markets' currencies. So it is reducing the odds. So what this Turkish crisis is, recently Donald Trump announced doubling of US import tariff on Turkish steel and aluminium, which creates a major imbalance in the Turkish economy. Already the Turkish economy is facing a lot of imbalances, like the current account deficit of Turkey is very large, and similarly high debt in the private sector and significant foreign funding, that is a lot of foreign funding in the banking system, and inflation of Turkish economy is reached an annual rate of 15.9%, which is greater than 5 times of an average nation's inflation rate. So you understand the severity, right? So also similarly, the banks in Turkey is also mounting with lot of debts, and least adequate levels of reserves or foreign exchange reserves is with Turkey. So these are all the crises which is in Turkey as of now. So this Donald Trump announcement is also putting some fuel to the fire. Is it just a local problem for the Turkey, or it is a problem for rest of the economy, in the sense it is affecting, it has a contagious effect. It is affecting all the emerging market. So if you see our country's economy in the sense, then the retail inflation fell to a 9-month low of 4.17%. That is, inflation is decreasing. Similarly, the wholesale inflation is also eased to 5.09%, which indicates some positivity in our Indian economy. But on the other hand, India's ballooning fiscal deficit and increase in the crude prices is also making the value of our currency to very less. And this month, that is this August month, has marked the largest devaluation of the rupee against the dollar, which is $1 equal to 70 rupees, right? So it is the worst performer in Asia. In Asia, India's Indian currency is the worst performer. So that is what suggested in this article. So, but if you see the positive side of this depreciation, then what they state is, depreciation of the currency is positive for textile and the clothing industry, because it increases the exports of our textile and the clothing to other countries in a very wider way. Similarly, rupee will need to depreciate in the medium term to keep up with the inflation differentials with the other trading partners or the other emerging economies. So usually depreciation encourages the exports, but it makes the imports costlier. But India nearly imports 80% of its need from the other countries only. So this depreciation might hurt our imports. So that is what they stated. But anyway, this depreciation of our Indian currency is a result of global factors. It is not due to any our internal factors. And also RBI have a forex reserve of $402.7 billion. It is in better position than other currencies or other emerging market economies' currencies, which means our Indian currency is not that much vulnerable when compared to other currencies. So the fourth article is launch of health scheme likely, which means Prime Minister Narendra Modi today is expected to launch this Ayushman Bharat National Health Protection Scheme, so which aims to give or provide a medical coverage of 5 lakh per family, and if it is provided, then it will benefit more than 10 crore poor families, especially the poor and the deprived rural families. As of now, 22 states are preferring to launch this health scheme, and the cost of 10,000 crore is estimated for this project. So if this healthcare scheme is getting implemented, then it will become the world's largest government-funded healthcare insurance program. So if you see an overall view of this Ayushman Bharat scheme, then this scheme will have a benefit cover of 5 lakh per family per year. Okay. So in this scheme, a beneficiary will be allowed to access cashless benefit from any private or the public hospitals across the country. And similarly, the state health agency is established in order to transfer the fund from the center to the state and then to the hospitals. So to make this even more faster and efficient, the Niti Aayog is now in partnership with high robust modular and interoperable IT systems so that the operation will become paperless and cashless. So the next article is the market across the border. So it is about the trade relationship or the bilateral trade relationship between India and Pakistan. Over the last 5 years, India and Pakistan have a trade of nearly $1.4 billion, but anyway this trade is volatile. So what we actually need is the need for harmonious bilateral relationship. As of now, if you see here, the Pakistan's export to India is stable somewhat, but India's exports to Pakistan is now getting decreased. What we have to address here is, so through direct trade we are reaching this much potential, but through indirect trade, which means India and Pakistan is not directly trading, but through indirect, by means of through third countries like UAE and all, we are trading, and it is nearly 10 times more than the normal trading. So if we focus on that indirect trade, and if we address the indirect trade to direct trade, then it will increase our potential, our both countries' potential. So what we have to do is the tariff and the non-tariff barriers between the two countries needs to be addressed as of now. So what they are proposed here is, we should develop some kind of value chain between the trade which is happening between the two countries, especially because our global economy is very interdependent and integrated. So India and Pakistan need to diversify their imports and exports and intensify their integration, as well as they have to develop some kind of bilateral, product specific and regional value chains among the country. And we all know that these three are the regional value chains which is existing between India and Pakistan, the textile and clothing, goods and surgical equipments. So if you see here, these are all what the Pakistan have the potential to export to India, and these are all the potential that India have to export to Pakistan. Demand in India for Pakistani's fabric and designs is very high, nearly $2.3 billion, so we have to make that even more stronger. Similarly, Pakistan's sport goods manufacturing sector is emerging, so Sialkot, which is the global manufacturing sports good production center, so that is also, we have to make a relationship between India and Pakistan in order to gain these kind of sports goods from Pakistan. And Pakistan's surgical instruments manufacturing industry is also very expertise, so we have to make use of that surgical instrument manufacturing to us. So India, as we are a large market for this kind of medical instruments, we should get it from Pakistan. So what we have to do in return is, we have to supply some kind of stainless steel to Pakistan, which we are good at, because they have to make the surgical instruments and all, we have to provide them the basic raw materials in exchange. And similarly, we have the potential of exporting raw materials and semi-finished goods like latex, rubber and football bladders to Pakistan. And sport wear, sports good from Pakistan, similarly sports wear from India is in demand in Pakistan, so we can also export these things. All these things can be achieved only we have a harmonious bilateral trade relationship between between India and Pakistan. So what is the way forward here is we should bridge the gap between the actual trade and the potential trade, and that is the first priority. And we should alleviate the fears or misconceptions or the distrust which is existing between India and Pakistan. And border infrastructure and security should also get improved, and improved connectivity by means of sea and air should be ensured, and enhanced people-to-people contact and educational exchanges. These are all the way forward in order to make our bilateral relationship even more healthier. So the engagements at the political level will be an important factor to reinforce the economic ties between the two countries. So the sixth article is the chief election commissioner, what he tells about the proxy voting for NRIs and the fake news challenges and electoral bonds and why we need EVMs. So the first one is the proxy voting for NRIs. So nearly 3 crore people of Indian origin are living abroad. But if we see the number of people who are getting registered in the electoral rolls, then it is very less than 25,000. Why? Because for each and every time during the election, they have to come here, they have to spend a lot of money. It makes them demotivated, right? So to ensure or to encourage the NRIs to participate in election, this proxy voting was introduced by the parliament. So the election commission actually suggested 2 options. One is to appoint the proxies for the NRIs to vote or postal ballot system. But now they chose this proxy voting. So the second article is paid news versus fake news. So earlier there was a paid news problem, but now it's emerging is the fake news problem. On addressing this fake news problem, the election commissioner, the chief election commissioner, what he told is during the election time, this fake news spreading is creating a major imbalance in our country. So to address this, according to the section 126 of ROPA, which is the Representation of the People Act, they are engaged with Facebook, Twitter and other social media platform in order to curb the proliferation of fake messages regarding the government or regarding the election results or polls, etc. So that is what one more thing he told about. So the third one is reverting to a paper ballot system as like Europe. So recently the Congress party is also talking about this reverting to a paper ballot system from recently prevailing electronic voting machine system. But to answer this question, what he said is reverting to a paper ballot system is not best option, because in countries like Europe, they are not even devising some standalone machines for carrying out these elections. So similarly, this EVM system in India is also used to address a lot of issues which are prevailing during the paper ballot system, like invalid votes or booth capturing and all. And the paper ballot system also generally took a very longer time, but this EVM machine is becoming very efficient. So transparency in funding to political parties is always a major issue. To overcome that issue, these electoral bonds are getting implemented. So what this electoral bonds is, it is a bearer bond which doesn't have the name of who gives to whom, or it never discloses the giver's information. It only has the taker's information. So the chief election commissioner also raising a concern that if it fails, this electoral bonds are fails to bring the transparency, then it is not a healthy democracy. That is what he stated in this article. So the next one is simultaneous polls. So the simultaneous polls means both the Lok Sabha election and the state assembly election should be happen simultaneously. So what his viewpoint towards this simultaneous election or simultaneous poll is, if only all the political parties are accepting to the simultaneous poll, then only it is possible.